Well, we want to welcome you to our new series, Mythbusters. And today we launch out in an exciting venture to understand with greater and greater depths what God wants you and I to be. It's what He is. God literally is a Mythbuster. How many have watched the popular Discovery Channel show Mythbusters? Yeah, a lot of you have. So Adam Savage and Jamie Hyneman have hosted that show for 14 years, and they have just really literally finished that just this last spring. March was their last episode, and Mythbusters, the show, would bust all kinds of myths that we're not particularly concerned about. One of those myths was, if you eat a poppy seed muffin, will it distort or confuse your drug test? Well, I hope your drug test doesn't have to happen real soon, but you'll have to watch one of those episodes to find out for sure. They do things like put flammable ingredients in a toilet and light a match to see if it'll explode. You can try that at home if you like, or watch an episode to see if that comes true or not. Their desire, though, is to take all kinds of myths and discover if they are fact or fiction, if they are true or false. And so as they did that, it gained popularity over the years. In fact, even the producers now say even though they are not hosting, there will probably be some kind of remake of the show because people are always fascinated about myths. And so I thought, as I meditated on a scripture earlier this year, actually late spring, I thought this would be a great series to launch into as we open our Atwater service. So I want you all in Merced to welcome the folks in Atwater for the grand opening. Can you do that? Hey! Yes. We are so excited that so many people in Atwater have said, we want Yosemite Church to come and be a blessing to our community. And over the last month, the soft start has consistently had about 110 to 150 people coming, and I'm looking forward to hearing what the numbers are today for the grand opening, but we are so excited. Atwater, welcome as a part of our church family. When we bust myths, we really are just saying that what God does all the time, we want to learn how to do, because God's in the business of breaking myths. So I want us to think about myths for a little bit. The first point in your notes today really is just why become a myth buster? Why become a myth buster? And to do that, we want to look at a couple of scriptures that just kind of tell us God's heart to set us free. God's intentions for your life and mine to flourish. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7 and 8 with me, if you would please. It says, have nothing to do with godless myths. Circle those two words, would you? Godless myths. Have nothing to do with godless myths. Rather, train yourself to be godly, for physical training is of some value, but godliness has value for all things, holding promise for both the present life and the life to come. Circle the word where it says life and circle life to come. Part of what Paul, the author here, writing to a young pastor, Timothy, wanted him to know is that part of his assignment, part of his job, is to help people, his congregation, to bust myths. Because as myths were prevalent in that culture, they are extremely prevalent in ours. Indeed, the things that hold you captive, literally what Scripture would say are bondages because you have believed some kind of mythical idea. You're holding on to something that is false, that's not true, that's fictional. Maybe it's a half-truth, and it holds you back from experiencing both life here and life to come. And so we're going to look not only at busting myths, but what do we do in contrast to that to be freed from mythical thinking? The second scripture I wanted to share with you comes from Jesus in John chapter 13, verse 31 and 32. So compare with me what Jesus said to what Paul said. Jesus said, if you hold on to my teaching, you really are my disciples, then you will know what? Then you will what? Know the truth, and the truth will do what? It'll set you free. Jesus goes on to say that the thief, referring to Satan, comes to kill, steal, and destroy, but I have come that they may have life and have it how? To the full. Notice, circle again the words life and circle truth. Jesus wants to set us free with the truth, and that truth is here to give us life right here and right now. Isn't that similar to what Paul said? That training that leads to godliness is profitable for life and the life to come. So both biblical authors are concerned about us having a life that's to the fullest, Then I define myth for you. So in your notes, look at what a myth is. A myth is a fiction or a half-truth, especially that forms part of one's ideology or belief system. It's a widely held but false belief or idea. So kind of, you know, why become a mythbuster? Here's kind of the reason why, and the first point of your notes, is because we cannot experience the blessing that God has for us, the freedom that God has for us, while holding on to a mythical idea, a lie, or a misbelief. You can't experience all the life that God has for you, that He wants for you, while you also hold on to a mythical idea or concept about God. Now, there are all kinds of myths. I mean, if Mythbusters could run for 14 years, right, and have episode after episode after episode of myths, we got to kind of clarify what kind of myths we're going to be dealing with. We're not really concerned about some of those classical myths. In fact, how many watched the Olympics this year? Some of it. Man, I watched the Olympics. I mean, every chance I got, I was watching the Olympics. I love it. It's inspiring, right, to see the different athletes perform. Just an amazing thing. The whole idea of the Olympics started in 776 B.C. 776 B.C. was the first record of the first Olympics that took place. And all it was a running competition. It was a foot race. And then a few hundred years later, they added a few more things. And they began to have the Olympics on a regular basis every 4 years from that time. And it went on for centuries. 4,000 years ago, it started. And it was all built around a mythical figure. It was built around the worship of Zeus, the Greek god Zeus. And to celebrate and worship Zeus, they started the Olympics. Kind of crazy, yeah. Kind of my mythical thinking. Well, I'm not real concerned that you believe in Zeus, so we're not going to have a sermon, you know, busting the myth of whether Zeus is real or not. That's not our concern. There's all those kind of classical mythical figures in history. I'm not concerned about you believing in the Greek gods, and so we're not going to tackle those. I'm not concerned, but I am a little concerned about how our kids can kind of be skewed by a similar kind of classical myth of our day, of our culture, and that is pretty much on the shoulders of Disney. There are so many mythical stories about great characters, right? Every fairy tale, right, that you have from Disney promotes this idea. And it's an idea that we all love. It's kind of an idea that you can live happily ever after if your prince will come. You know, someday my prince will come. Some of you really, you're longing for that. Young girls grow up looking for their prince to come. There's a story I like to tell about Cinderella. And it's a little bit of a distortion to it, but see if you can follow me. Once upon a time in a corn functory, there lived a very beautiful girl, and her name was Rindersella. Now, Rindersella lived with her muggly other and two sad bisters. Also in the same corn functory, there lived a very prancing Hince. And this prancing Hince was going to throw a bansy fall, so he invited the people from riles a mound, especially the pitch people. Well, Rindersella wanted to go to the bansy fall, so did her muggly other and two sad bisters who went out to buy some drancy fesses to wear to the bansy fall, but Rindersella couldn't go because all she had to wear was some old rooty dags. So the night of the bansy fall arrived, and Rindersella couldn't go, so she just kept down and scried. And she was kitten there scrying when all of a sudden there appeared before her her Gary Mudfather. And he touched her with his wagic mand, and bo and behold, there appeared before her a King Boach and Hicks White's horses to take her to the bansy fall. And she looked in the mirror and she had the dranciest fess of all. Well, Rindersella's Gary Mudfather said, Rindersella, you can go to this here bansy fall on cone one dition. You must be home before midnight, or I will turn you into a tumpkin. So the night of the bansy fall arrived, and Rindersella went to the bansy fall, and the prancing Hince met her at the door because he'd been watching behind a wooden window. And Rindersella and the prancing Hince danced all night until midnight, and they lell in love. Finally, the mid clock struck night, and Rindersella staced down the rares, and just as she beached the rod, she slopped her dripper. Well, that next day, that prancing Hince went all over that corn functory looking for the beautiful girl who slopped her dripper. Finally, he came to Rindersella's house, and he tried the slop dripper on the muggly other, and it fitted it. So he tried the slop dripper on the two sigly usters, and it fitted it. Finally, he tried the slop dripper on Rindersella, and it fitted it. It was exactly the site rise. Well, Rindersella and the Pransom Hints Lellenfoved and lived heavily after Happards. Now, the story to this here Maury is this. If you want to loll and flove with the Pransom Hints, you're going to have to go to a Bansy Fall, but don't forget to slop your dripper. Oh, wow, that's a crazy story. That may be a different way than you've heard it before, right? But you could pick up on something that sounded right and something that sounded off, right? That's what a mythbuster can do. A mythbuster can pick up on what's true, but they can detect what's not so true. They can see what's accurate, but also discern what is inaccurate. And in this series, the reason why we need to become mythbusters is because we'll never experience the freedom and the blessing that God has for us while believing a lie. And so I wonder what lies you believe. I wonder what kind of lies have held you captive and kept you from experiencing the joy and the promise of godliness, both in this life and in the life to come. Amen. In this series, we want to talk about how to do that. And week after week, we are going to bust through myths. Things you tell yourself that hold you back from experiencing and being the person God wants you to be. The residual of that is that we have something then to offer our children. A better ability to discern the myths they believe, because our culture literally inundates our kids with all kinds of mythical ideas that distract them and pull them away from understanding who God truly is. You'll notice if you have come around the perimeter of the room that we've got some tables around the perimeter of the room, and there are mirrors on those. If this is blinding anybody over here, I really apologize for that. The mirror is kind of bright. And so, I don't know if you can kind of see this. Can you see what I just wrote on there? Try, yeah. So if we were going to break through a myth, bust through a myth today, we'd be busting through the myth that says, try your best. Just try. Just try. The myth of try tells us that if you try something, it might work out. But if you try and it didn't work out so good, you can say, well, I'm not going to do that because I tried. I did that. I tried. I tried to be a good person. I tried to be a good Christian. I tried to know God. I tried and didn't work out. You see, the truth about what God wants us to know is that trying all by itself is a myth. Is a myth when it comes to spirituality. We're going to look at a couple things in your notes. The first thing is the reality about the problem of myths. I wanted to say also around the room, the tables have mirrors on them, and you can go to each mirror, they've got markers there, and you can write out a myth that maybe you think something sounds kind of true, and you think it's a myth though, and you can write your myth on a mirror. And hopefully, it'll be a myth that I can kind of tie in through our series and address that myth. So if something comes to you, I think this is something that I kind of wrestle with and I tend to believe, but it's not true, and I wonder what God would say about that belief, then write that on a mirror, and we may address that sometime in our series. Does that make sense? Okay. Because the truth is, the myths that we want to address are not the innocuous kind proposed by Disney, but the kind that distort either your view of who God is or distort God's view of you. Those are the kind of myths that we want to tackle, because those are the myths that rob us of experiencing what God has for us. When I don't see God accurately and I don't see myself accurately, I've got a distorted reflection of who I am. And so as I correct the myths in my life, I have a more accurate reflection of who I am and I can be the person God wants me to be. But that doesn't happen until I bust through that distortion. So this is the problem. In our notes, the problem is that mythical thinking creates a vulnerability for all of us. I want us to look at another passage of Scripture. There are five times when the word myth, it's mythos, kind of a compared to logos or logos, which is the word, and Jesus literally defined as the logos, the word. Logos was used, it means word, a true statement. Jesus is the truest statement of all, John chapter 1, verse 1 through 5 tell us. Logos. In contrast to that, mythos is that idea that something is false and distorted and fictional. Maybe it has a semblance of truth, but it has enough distortion to draw you in and deceive you from what God wants for you, which is true. So in that distortion, a second time that the Apostle Paul used this, only five times in the New Testament this word is used, was in 2 Timothy chapter 4 as well. It says, Paul, speaking first of all to Timothy in his command as a young pastor, says, preach the word, be prepared in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke, and encourage. How? With great patience and careful instruction. Now, I'll mention a little bit later, that's going to be my job. Okay, so throughout the series, I'm going to try to preach the word. I'm going to try to be prepared in season and out of season, which what does that kind of imply? If I'm prepared in season and out of season, then I'm constantly prepared. That's actually how God wants all of us to be. He wants you and I to be prepared for the lies that come to us in season and out of season, in winter and in fall, in summer and in spring. All the time, He wants us to be ready. To know God's word, to preach the word, be prepared. And then he wants this young pastor, as he would want me, to kind of motivate you to be the best you can be, but to do that with patience and careful instruction. And I will seek to do that. That's kind of my part of this job. For you, it's this next part. This next part speaks about a progression that takes place. Look what he says in verse 3 out of the New Living Translation. It says, for a time is coming, and I propose has already come, when people will no longer listen, circle those words, to sound and wholesome teaching. They will circle, follow their own desires, and will look for teachers who will tell them whatever their itching ears want to hear. And they will reject the truth and chase after myths. Now, in terms of sentence structure, when you study Scripture, you kind of look for sentence structure. So this section, verse 3 and 4, starts out with, they will, people will, and then they will do multiple things. So look at the progression with me. They will no longer listen. Have you ever tuned someone out? I mean, they were talking, blah, 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 right? They were talking, but you were not listening. Have you ever tuned out the wrong thing? Has there ever been a time in your life, maybe you can look back over your own history and say, someone was telling me something that was really good, but I was too caught up in something else, and I just tuned them out. For every one of us that have a parent, every one of us that are parents, understand that our children at some point in their life have a propensity to tune out our good wisdom, don't they? It seems like children, when they move into their adolescent years, they get smarter and you get dumber. Right? Right? They all of a sudden know what they want and you ain't got a clue. And they do this very first thing that Paul was telling Timothy would come. There comes a time in almost every child's life when they will no longer listen to sound and wholesome teaching. You see, that's the first he gives in kind of a progression of things that take place. And so kind of look at the progression with me. They no longer listen. And what's the second thing? They follow their own desires. I have often said that I am my worst enemy. Have you ever been your worst enemy? That your own desires get contaminated, they get distorted, and the world around us wants to feed that distortion. Why? Because it wants to tell you, you can have it any way you want it. One of the myths that we'll be looking at is that one. You can have it any way you want it. Our desires feed our craving for mythical ideas. As a young person, that mythical concept could feed the idea that I'll never fail. I'll never fail. In fact, even some parents feed their children that idea, that you're not going to fail, go ahead and do it. And the truth is, you are going to fail. And the truth is that maybe your successes will not make you successful, but your failures might. That the very things that looks like a difficulty and an obstacle might be the thing that God wants to leverage for His good and your good. But the mythical idea that you won't fail will leave you set up for a fall. Maybe it's the mythical idea that you can be anything you want to be. You can be anything you want to be. You can do anything you want to do. Our culture feeds young people that myth all the time. And the truth is, you can't be anything you want to be. You got to discover who God has made you to be and be that. When you discover the gifts and abilities and strengths that He's put into you, that's what He wants you to be. And so we'll confront that myth along with many other. We'll confront the myth that life should be fair. And if you hold on to the myth that life should be fair, then every time it's not, you end up shaking your fist at God because you cannot comprehend why life is not fair. We'll also confront the myth that time heals all wounds. Just for your information, not on your life. Sometimes time just makes those wounds more bitter, more deeply rooted in your psyche and your unconsciousness. But it comes out in your relationships. It creates bitterness and strife, anger and worry and angst. You see, the very things you hold on to in your thinking reverberate through your entire system in your emotions. And your emotions can be a warning light that you may be believing a lie, a mythical concept. You see, the problem is prevalent, and the problem is true for every one of us. And once our desires have latched onto a lie, look at the next thing it feeds. They look for teachers that will tell them what their itching ears want to hear. And there's no better place to find it than on the internet. I can find whatever teacher I want to tell me whatever I want to hear, and it's just a couple clicks away. And in our society, we are bombarded by messages. We tune out those that are speaking the truth, and we tune in to those who are making a lie. And what we end up doing, the next progression, is we reject the truth, or literally the NIV says turn away. And this concept of turn away is one of those predominant themes of Scripture. He said we turn away from the truth, and we turn toward lies. Or the NIV says we reject the truth, and we chase after lies. And certainly we see that all around us. So part of what we want to do in this series is we want to bolster the fact that God's called us to be a loving community of growing disciples, mentoring the next generation, to live the mission of Jesus through the power of the gospel. You see, that power of the gospel is the power to set us free from mythical concepts and ideas. But we've got to learn how to embrace the truth, and we've got to recognize the problem. If I never recognize the problem, I'll never discover the solution. And so the first thing for all of us to do is recognize I'm vulnerable, and that's kind of the bottom line to this point, is that we're all vulnerable to believing a mythical idea. Listen to what Romans chapter 1, verse 22 and 25 says about the people of old. He says, although they knew God, they neither glorified Him as God nor gave thanks to Him, but they're what? Circle that. You can't circle it. It's not in your notes. Open your Bible and circle that. Their thinking became futile and their foolish hearts were darkened. Look what they did. They exchanged the truth of God for a lie and worshiped and served created things rather than the Creator. You see, people do it all the time. They've been doing it for centuries. This reference may go all the way back to the Garden of Eden, when they exchanged the truth of God for a lie, which is if you eat of this tree, you can be like God. And so over and over when it says you can be like God, what are we wanting? What did Adam and Eve want to be like God? They wanted to be in control and in charge and have to answer to no one. But the truth is, one day every knee will bow and every tongue will confess, right? Everyone will have to answer to God. The truth is, you can never have such independence that you'll never answer to anyone. But in our flesh and in our mythical thinking, we want to answer to no one, to do our own thing. God wants to empower you in this series to look at that problem, to face that problem, to say, I'm vulnerable to mythical thinking. And if I don't confront that, I may not only distort my own life, I may project and give and pass that on to the lives of my children. You see, the truth is, there are no Gary Mudfathers. There's no magic wand that someone's going to wave over you and make everything right in an instant. The truth is, if you want to live happily ever after, you're going to have to recognize the one that can unscramble your myths and tell you the truth, that there is promise for this life and the life to come when you understand what godliness is and what the contrast to mythical beliefs are. The solution, let's talk about that. Back to our theme verse in 1 Timothy chapter 4. I want you to notice the first phrase, have nothing to do with. Literally, this word is a present imperative in the Greek. That means that it's a continuous action. It's something that's always present, and it's imperative that you should do. You should always learn how to turn away. So it has that same notion as the second Timothy passage. They turned away from the truth and turned towards chasing after myths. Have nothing to do with has the connotation of turning away from godless myths and old wives' tales. Oh, an old wives' tale, right? Is it feed a cold, starve a fever? Feed a cold, starve a fever. That's like an old wives' tale, right? You know, it's never good to starve your body. When your body's in crisis, it's never good to starve it, right? We say that all the time, and we may even do that because we buy into the old wives' tale. You know, we're not going to cover a lot of old wives' tales that are, again, innocuous like our myths, but Paul's saying, what are you thinking? You got to stop and recognize the solution has to do with arresting our thoughts, and something has to happen for us to learn how to do that, and he tells us that in the next phrase. Have nothing to do with godless myths and old wives' tales. Rather, do what? Circle the word, train yourself to be godly. For physical training has some value, but godliness has value for all things, holding promise for both the present life and the life to come. You see, everything that he builds this off of is around that little word train. Train. You see, train is the antithesis to try. Train is the antithesis to try. If I want to stop trying, I got to start training. And so rather than say, you know, I tried to live a Christian life, I tried to love God, I tried to serve others, but I didn't work very good, I got burned at the church, and so I'm not trying anymore. That's a myth. You see, you can try all you want to, you can white knuckle all you want to, that will never produce the godliness that God wants for you. Jay Adams, in his book, The Guide to Becoming a Christian Counselor, says this. He begs the question, what is the secret to godliness? And in a word, he says, is discipline. He goes on and say, the word discipline has disappeared from the minds, mouths, and pulpits of our culture. Modern American society hardly knows what discipline means. Yet, apart from discipline, there is no way to attain godliness. Discipline is God's path to godliness. The counselor, I would say the pastor or the teacher or the parent, therefore must learn how to help the counselee, the congregate, or the child to discipline him or herself for the purpose of godliness. You see, that word train could be translated discipline. In many translations, it is. It says, discipline yourself for the purpose of godliness. Other translations will translate that exercise. Exercise to achieve godliness. That child just gets upset just thinking about exercise. It's a little bit like you, probably. I mean, we can just say, you know, exercise just makes me want to cry. God says, you know what, there is something beautiful in our culture, in our minds and mouths and pulpits. We've lost the idea of discipline because we've turned it into a negative, bad word. It's not a bad word at all. You know deep down exercise is good for you, right? Yes? Yeah. And so why do you resist it? Because in your flesh you've bought into an idea that it should just be easy. And, hey, I tried exercise and the weight came back on. Right? Exercise is not something one does for a season to prove it successful. It's what one does for a lifestyle to prove it authentic. You see, God wants you and I to recognize that discipline is woven all throughout the Scriptures. Literally, it is a part of the fruit of the Spirit. Did you know the fruit of the Spirit is, among other things, self-control? It's discipline. It's a part of who it is. In an extra credit verse in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7, it says, God did not give us a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power, of love, and of self-discipline. Literally, it's a part of who God has made us to be, and we resist that. You will resist it. Why? Because you buy into the myth that I shouldn't have to. I shouldn't have to exert energy. I shouldn't have to try too hard. And so we get confused about faith that is absolutely given to us as a free gift of God, that God gives us the ability to enter into relationship with Him through grace, because our salvation is nothing we work for. I don't have to train to be saved. I just have to recognize I need to be saved and that He's the Savior. And so I confuse the idea of this free gift with the fact that to live this gift out requires effort and energy and exertion. And without effort, energy, and exertion, I'm not getting anywhere of very significant progress in my faith. Scriptures make it clear that there's a difference between ineffective faith and effective faith. And the person who has effective faith has put their heart and soul into following Christ with abandon. And so in this series, much of what we want to stir up in you is a realization that, do I want a beautiful, brilliant faith? Or do I want one that's anemic and weak and exhausted and weary and wants to throw in the towel because we say, I tried, It just didn't work out. You see, God wants us to do more than try. He wants us to train. Do you want to train? God wants to equip you to know what that looks like. And for this to happen, so that my part of this is to preach the word, right? My part is to help train you. And scriptures say over and over in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 2, it says about the pastor, to pass on whatever you've learned from me to reliable leaders who are, I don't know if it's up there, Garrett, or not, but the word says competent to lead others. You don't become competent by trying. You become competent by training. I mentioned earlier the Olympics. Did you have a favorite part of the Olympics? How many love the runners? Mr. Bolt, yeah, that guy is fast, right? Man, he's an amazing person, right? I love the gymnastics. Do you like the gymnastics? Simone Biles, wasn't she amazing? I mean, that little girl, phenomenal athlete, right? Phenomenal gymnast. In fact, her co-gymnast, Allie, said about, and Allie's phenomenal too. She's a beautiful young lady, did a tremendous job, got the silver in the floor exercise right next to Simone, who got the gold. And Allie said, you know, when Simone is doing things, displaying her talent and skill, I don't even think about her as a competitor. She is in a league of her own. And so she's not intimidated by her gifts. She just thinks she's in a league of her own. I mean, Simone's going to do things that nobody's ever done before. And she was amazing. You know how old Simone was when she started gymnastics? Six. 6 years old. So her debut on the Olympic platform has all these medals, right? Well, one of the most decorated gymnast of all time, right? The most medals ever won by a single gymnast. Pretty amazing. Probably the only person we could say is a little more astounding in their accrual of gold would be Michael Phelps, right? And so Michael's amazing physique adds to his ability, right? Because somewhere in his growing up, he discovered part of what God had given him, an amazing physique that's perfect for swimming. That long torso, those long legs, those broad shoulders. I mean, the man's built, you know, to be not just a great man, but almost a fish. And at 7 years of age, Michael started swimming, right? Partially because he had so much energy, they wanted to give him something constructive to do. So you see, every single Olympic athlete had to stop trying at some point and start training to be the men or women they wanted to be. And they loved their sport, and they loved their skill, and they loved their ability to grasp what was in their reach that could only be attained not by trying, but by training. And the Apostle Paul borrows from the Olympic world this word train. It's the word in Greek gymnasia, which comes from where we get our word gymnasium. And it was most prominently used about Olympic athletes. And Paul grabs that word out of that pagan culture and says, just as we all stand amazed at Olympic athletes, people will stand amazed at your ability to love when you've trained yourself to be a great lover. People will stand amazed at your ability to love the Lord Jesus Christ and to love His bride, His people, when you have trained to promote unity instead of disunity. Because you try to promote unity, pretty soon someone's going to step on your toes and all of a sudden you're not going to feel very united. But when someone steps on your toes and you still proclaim the goodness of the body of Christ and our ability to let forgiveness overcome adversity and challenge and grievances and hurt feelings, then you've recognized you have just lifted up the name of Christ that will draw all men to Him because you have represented the unity of the body. I love the little gymnast said, we're the final five, right? They dubbed themselves that because they had such confidence, not only in their individual abilities, but in their team abilities. You see, you can't try to be a good member of a team. You got to train to be a good member of a team. If you've tried and you want to fall out of the team makeup and network, then you have literally misunderstood the very fabric of who God calls us to be as the Church of Jesus Christ, which is a body, which is this functioning system that requires all kinds of different talents and skills and abilities. And yet when working together, it is a beautiful display of what God wants to do in His body and His church and you and I. And as we bust through those kind of myths that are in the world, we will overcome the things that keep us from being who God wants us to be. That's what God wants you to do in this series, because there's a problem out there. There's a problem that says you can do it all on your own. We'll bust that myth and others that promote independence rather than interdependence. And as we begin to recognize those myths and we begin to shatter those myths, all of a sudden we'll begin to find life and life to the full. And so I hope that you want to turn your back on your independence and your desire to be a solo athlete and recognize God wants you to be a synchronized part of the body of Christ. A synchronized part of the body of Christ. You know, as I watched the Olympics, there was one unlikely group, my guy friends tell me, that I really was drawn to. And that was synchronized swimming. I don't know if anyone watched that. Some folks said, some of the guys I talked to, when I mentioned that, they said, is that even a sport? I mean, how'd that get in the Olympics? Well, not only, I mean, women's legs, I suppose that would probably draw you partially, but amazing, those girls, how many watch the synchronized swimming? You ought to Google it. You ought to go on and watch, because it is astounding what those young women do in synchronization. I mean, under the water, maybe it's because I'm a terrible swimmer that I'm also amazed, right? I would have drowned in a heartbeat. But all the stuff they do under the water, and they will have their feet up in the air, then their hands up in the air, then their heads down into the water for what seems like a minute. It's a 4-minute exercise entirely. And then all of a sudden, one of them will come into the middle, and they will rocket that person out of the water and shoot them up 10 feet in the air. And they'll do a somersault and come right back down and join in sequence with the rest of the girls. I mean, it's phenomenal. It's phenomenal. I mean, just as we stand or probably sit amazed at those Olympic athletes, God wants the world to stand amazed at how much you and I love one another. He wants us to synchronize our ability to love well. He wants us to synchronize our ability to die to our flesh and walk away from our own fleshly desires, which was the second thing they did in the progression of believing a myth. They didn't want to listen, and then they followed their own desires of independence and stepped away from the necessity of being dependent on God and interdependent on one another. And God wants to draw you and I back to the understanding that we need a solution, and that solution is not to try, but to train. And that will not happen unless you embrace the idea that it's going to have to be changing the way you think. That will not happen. There should be a blank in your notes. That will not happen unless you come to the place where you begin to embrace the idea and reality that you've got to learn to change how you think. Because the culture around you wants to distort your beliefs, and they will do it with mythical ideas that capture the attention of your flesh and pull you off course so you turn away from what is true and you chase after what is mythical. And every time that happens, God will have a desire to pull you back to that place where He reminds and whispers to you, focus on Me. Fix your attention on Me. In fact, one of my favorite scriptures, Romans chapter 12, verse 2 says, don't become so well adjusted to your culture that you fit into it without even, you can circle this one, can't you? It's in your notes. Without what? Without even thinking. Instead, fix your attention on God. You'll be changed from the inside out. Readily recognize what God wants for you and quickly respond to it. Unlike the culture around you always dragging you down to its level of immaturity, God brings out the best in you, develops well-formed maturity in you. You see, why? Because God's the greatest coach. God's the greatest coach that comes alongside and wants to encourage you and coach you and counsel you. The Spirit literally would inhabit you. So you're changed from the inside out, saying, I'm not going to try, I'm going to train, and I'm going to make progress in this journey of faith. And in this series, you might be able to make more progress than you've ever done before, because maybe, just maybe, you'll take this to the next 3 points and you'll say, number one, Pastor, I'm willing to decide to train. Three things to take away with you this morning. The first one is to decide to enter into training. Now when you do this, I want to again weave another prominent passage of Scripture where this is reinforced. Jesus said, are you tired and weary? And that's what you become when you're trying a lot. When you're trying really hard, you're white-knuckling it, it's very natural for you to just be tired and weary and want to give up. And Jesus, if that's what you are, you want to give up, are you tired or weary, come to me, all you are weary and burdened, I will give you rest. Take my, and here's the key word, take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your soul. The Message Bible says you'll find a rhythm in your living, a rhythm and ability to kind of stick with it and go beyond where you thought you could, and a synchronization of relationships whenever you have yoked yourself with Jesus. So what was a yoke? Remember what a yoke was? How many know what yokes are? Yokes are like, you know, you have an oxen and it's got a yoke, and it's got oftentimes two yokes for two oxen. So here's what they would do whenever they were training a young ox. So a young ox is ready to go into the field and begin to work. They just don't take that two young ox and put them together and expect to get anything done. The two young ox would never get anything accomplished. So we'd constantly fight against the yoke. And so they take a young ox and they hook it up with their most experienced, intuitive animal. And they hook them together, and the one that wants to do its own thing keeps being pulled back by the other one that's stronger and more consistent and more trained and more reliable. You see, you will want to go your own way. But the scriptures say, Jesus said, yoke up with me, and I'll train you how to go my way. And all of a sudden, life will not become erratic, but routine. And that routine can become a habit, and that habit can become transformational. Maybe you've heard the little sequence, sow a thought, because you have to change your thinking. Sow a thought, reap an attitude. Sow an attitude, reap an action. Sow an action, reap a habit. Sow a habit, reap a character. Sow a character, reap a destiny. This life and the life to come. You see, godliness is profitable for you right now. You'll reap a destiny for your tomorrows and next months and next years, but you'll also reap a destiny of eternity in God's kingdom, where He says, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. Just wait till you see what I've got planned in eternity. God has a plan for you. The plan's not for trying. The plan's for training. Do you want to train? Do you want to enter into training and say, I'm done with trying. I want to start training, because if you're done with trying, then you're done with the erratic kind of spirituality that has you on one day and off the next. But training creates this ability to have momentum through the days and literally to see yourself making progress, and you go places you never thought you could go before. That's God's desired destiny for you. It's called freedom and blessing. Life and life to the full. Benefit now and then. That's what God has for you. But you've got to abandon the myth of try. I mean, try you might, don't you won't. I believe that. I mean, try is not a bad first step. It's just not a good long-distance plan. And so God wants to equip us in that. So the first thing is say, you know, Pastor, I want to decide. I want to decide to enter into training. The second thing is to choose to keep coming. Choose to keep coming. Hebrews, in the whole vein of weaving training into our lives, the apostle, we're not sure which apostle, maybe Paul, maybe Barnabas, writes this in chapter 10, verse 25. He says, let us never give up meeting together, as some are in the, what, circle? Habit of doing. Well, let's encourage one another. And all the more as we see the day approaching, our Olympic debut is coming. Keep at it. Encourage one another. Stimulate one another to try and to pursue. I think that the synchronized swimmers have a little bit of advantage because they have one another. Right? There's a reason that a gymnast can excel well individually. It's because they're not really an individual gymnast. Even though they're performing individually, they're also associated with a team. Because in that team is where we have encouragement one to another. So in this season, as we start small groups, what is a small group? A small group's a team. A small group's a community that says you don't have to do it alone. Because alone, you're going to feel isolated. And so now is a great time. We got men's groups, women's groups, youth groups, all kinds of small groups meeting almost every day of the week in Merced and Atwater. Yeah, Atwater! The last one, decide, choose, and apply. Apply. Every time a coach gives an athlete something to do. The success of that athlete is not based on what the coach says, but on what the athlete does with what the coach said. The coach can talk all day, can coach all day, can instruct all day. But until the athlete chooses to apply what the coach says, the athlete will make absolutely no progress whatsoever. And James, the brother of Jesus, says the same thing is in danger for you and I. He says in chapter 1, verse 22, do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Circle the next words. What are they? Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says, it's like a man who looks at his face in a mirror and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But the man who looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom, and circle the word, continues to do this. Sounds a lot like training, doesn't it? He keeps coming back to the gym. He keeps showing back up for exercise. He keeps going to the small group. He keeps coming every weekend. He keeps training and training and training, and he links those experiences, and all of a sudden, he continues to do this, and that man will be what? Blessed in what? Circle he does. That sounds an awful lot like life and life to the full, doesn't it? That sounds an awful lot like profitable for here and the hereafter, doesn't it? You see, now James lines up with Paul and Jesus and says, this is a time. This is a time when you can start to train and change everything about your future. Would you bow your heads with me? Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you, God, that you're an amazing Lord and Savior that love us entirely and completely. You love us, Lord, on our good days and bad days. You love us, Lord, when we try and we want to quit. You love us when we abandon all hope and walk away. In fact, it is in that place where you meet us oftentimes and you whisper to us, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened. I want to give you rest. I want to strengthen your soul. But that's going to require you being yoked up with me. That's going to require a different perspective of how to walk the Christian life. The free gift you've received by having a relationship with me has to be developed now into an ability to create stamina, spiritual stamina, resilience, and perseverance. But it's exactly who my spirit is. And so my spirit, I'm going to breathe into you. So that spirit's going to call out to you and say, don't just try. Train. Don't stop. Continue. Don't throw in the towel. Step up to the plate. And in that place, Lord, we find your rest, because we find your strength working inside of us, producing in us, Lord, a willingness and a commitment to follow hard after you. And so, Lord God, we ask you to help us to be trained for godliness, to be more like you. This morning, if you want to say, Pastor, I decide right now, spiritually with you in this prayer, I want to decide to enter training. Just raise your hand. I just want to decide right now. And if you were asking me, would you like to enter training? I raise my hand because I need that. I got to stop trying. I got to start training. Lord God, all these hands are up. And Lord, we hold them up proud. We hold them up confidently and say, Lord, my hand is a raised hand of desperation to have Jesus in me, fully alive, giving me life and life to the full. And Lord, I want to be yoked up with you and yoked up with others that are pulling in the same direction. If you want to continue to just proclaim your commitment, just say, I choose to show up throughout this series. Just keep your hand and just give it a little wave. Just say, Pastor, I'm going to show up in the series because I need to bust through every myth that holds me back. I just choose right now. And Lord, I want to apply. And now for an extra step, raise that other hand and say, I will raise my hands to you and apply what I'm learning. God, whatever I hear, I want to begin to say, how can I translate Sunday answers into Monday living? And so, Lord, I surrender and I give you all that I have. If you're here this morning, you've never said yes to Jesus, that free gift, which is easy to take in, is there for you. Maybe you're exhausted in life and you're tired in life and you need that awareness that you are loved no matter what. Then simply say, Lord God, I open my heart to you. And I invite Jesus, the Savior of the world, who died on the cross to pay for my sin debt. God, I invite you into my heart. Come in and refresh me. Come in and begin to change me. come in and turn my closed ears, Lord, open them to the sound of your voice. God, take my desires and turn them into your desires. God, help me not to turn away from the teaching of sound and wholesome truth, but to turn toward that and embrace who you are. God, I want to chase after you, not after the things of this world. I need you, so fill me with your presence today. Lord God, we ask all these things that we might honor you in the days to come. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Yay! Way to go! So glad you're here today. Please, before you take off, look around. See if you see someone that's unfamiliar to you, you've never met before. For some of you, that might be easy. For others, you got to look a little bit longer. Introduce yourself and simply ask this question. What will you take away with you today because you were here? What will you take away with you today because you're here? God bless. See you next week as we continue our series. Bye-bye.